The first time I heard of Loch Ness was in 1977. I was 9 years old watching an episode of the TV show In Search Of with Lenard Nimoy. Since my youth, the idea of a freshwater lake containing a monster was, and always has been, the perfect bedtime story. After all, what better backdrop for a monster story could there be than the Highlands of Scotland? Limited windows of good weather, most of the year shrouded in fog, rain, and snow, thousands of years of human history, and hundreds of years of stories of a legendary creature lurking the depths. With a length of 23 miles and an estimated depth of 755 feet, Loch Ness is the second largest loch in Scotland behind Loch Lomond in terms of surface area. But in terms of sheer volume, due to its depth, Loch Ness is the largest body of fresh water in all of the British Isles. Loch Ness is connected to the sea at the southern end by a section of the Caledonian Canal. At the northern end, there is the Bono Narrows, which feeds the River Ness, and a further section of canal, ultimately leading to the North Sea via the Moray Firth. The surface of Loch Ness is 52 feet above sea level. Loch Ness is part of the Great Glen Fault Line that runs southwest and northeast for over 60 miles across the Highlands. Earthquakes up to 4 on the Richter scale are recorded roughly 3 times a year, with the last large quake in 1816. It was strong enough to be felt over most of Scotland. But without a doubt, the key of Loch Ness is not its size, geology, or seismic activity, but it is the legend of the Loch Ness Monster. The earliest report of a monster in the vicinity of Loch Ness appears in the book Life of St. Columba, written in 565 AD. According to the author, whose writing took place roughly a century after the events took place, the Irish monk St. Columba was staying in the land of the Picts with his companions when he encountered local residents burying a man by the River Ness. They explained that the man was swimming in the river when he was attacked by a water beast that mauled him and dragged him underwater. They had tried to rescue him in a boat, but he was killed. In October of 1871 or 1872, Dee Mackenzie described an object resembling a log or an upturned boat wringling and churning up the water. The object moved slowly at first, disappearing at a faster speed. In 1888, Alexander MacDonald sighted a large stubby-legged animal surfacing from the loch and propelling itself within 50 yards of the shore. He described the creature as looking like a salamander. On July 22, 1933, George Spicer and his wife saw a most extraordinary form of animal cross the road in front of their car. They described the creature as having a large body, about 4 feet high and 25 feet long, and a long, wavy, narrow neck, slightly thicker than an elephant's trunk, and as long as the 10 to 12 foot width of the road. They saw no limbs. It lurched across the road towards the loch 20 yards away, leaving a trail of broken undergrowth in its wake. Hugh Gray was the first person to have claimed to have photographed the creature, November 12, 1933. But it is perhaps the surgeon's photograph in 1934 that has lit the mystery ablaze, when on the 21st of April 1934, the Daily Mail published a photograph supposedly taken by Robert Kenneth Wilson, a London doctor. For 86 years, the debate over its authenticity has continued. At the time, the doctor forbid his name to be used in connection with the photograph. This was followed by the Taylor film in 1938. Then on the 15th of August 1938, William Fraser, chief constable of the Inverness Shire, wrote a letter that the monster existed beyond doubt and expressed concern about a hunting party that had arrived with a custom-made harpoon gun determined to catch the monster, dead or alive. He believed his power to protect the monster from the hunters was very doubtful. The letter was released by the National Archive of Scotland on the 27th of April 2010. In December 1954, sonar readings were taken by the fishing boat Rival 3. Its crew noted a large object keeping pace with the vessel at a depth of 479 feet. It was detected for 2,600 feet before contact was lost. The decades that have followed have revealed more pictures, such as Peter McNabb's shot near Urquhart Castle, July 29, 1955, and the Dinsdale film of 1960. In 1993, Discovery Communications produced a documentary, Loch Ness Discovered, with a digital enhancement of the Dinsdale film. A person who enhanced the film noticed a shadow in the negative that was not obvious in the developed film. By enhancing and overlaying frames, he found what appeared to be the rear body of a creature underwater. He is quoted as saying, "Before I saw the film, I thought the Loch Ness Monster was a load of rubbish. Having done the enhancement, I'm not so sure." On the 26th of May, 2007, Gordon Holmes filmed what he said was this jet black thing, about 46 feet long, moving fairly fast in the water. Adrian Shine, a marine biologist at the Loch Ness 2000 Center, described the footage as among the best footage he had ever seen. As the decades have rolled on, as technology has grown, the researching and testing of the Loch has continued, with sightings continuing to the present day. There are no shortages of photos, videos, and claims to the beast's existence. So what do you think? Is there a monster living in Loch Ness? Is it somehow making its way through the connected river system, accessing the North Sea, only to return to the murky depths it calls home? Please leave your comments below, and if you enjoyed this video, please give it a thumbs up and consider liking, subscribing, and sharing. Thanks.